You can also maybe infer some things about the locations adjacent to it, right? Or similarly, if you know there's not a wall somewhere, you can infer some things about the locations adjacent, because these are not completely independent. If there's one kind of object in one position, you can expect maybe the same thing in the adjacent position, right? And this is the idea of mutual information. Nonetheless, I have some definitions of mutual information. Don't worry too much about it. I think it's more intuitive to think about the Venn diagram here. So if you have the entropy, the amount of information about two different variables, that would be sort of both of the circles, like all together, that's the entropy of the entire system. And the entropy of just x, just one of them would be this green circle, and just blue would be this circle. If you are given x, like say you like sampled x and you now know x, then the amount of entropy of y given x is just going to be this cutout over here. And similarly, on the other hand, if you're given y, the amount of entropy left in x given y is going to be this thing. The overlap of the Venn diagram is what's called the mutual information, and that's the amount of information that you can gain. And that's sort of the overlap in the information. So for example, if you had two coins, and when you flipped one of the coins, you for some reason knew that the other coin would also come up the same way, then the mutual information would sort of be the entire Venn diagram, right? On the other hand, if you had two completely independent coins, like, you know, most coins, there would be no overlap because you're not actually gaining any information from flipping one for the result of the other, right? And the basic idea, basically the way that you can use this in the context of adaptive sampling is saying, you know, imagine you're performing a slam on this room and you go and you sample that back corner. And then if you want to figure out where to sample next, you might already know that the place is sort of adjacent to that back corner, like, you know, maybe the window or something. You probably already have a reasonably good idea of what's over there just based on sampling. So you're going to want to go and sample somewhere far away, which maybe intuitively makes sense. So we talked about the exploitation side, and we talked about the exploration side. The next thing we want to talk about is the trade-off between them. How do we explore and exploit? So often, you know, so sometimes your goal is just, you know, go towards the Easter egg and get the Easter egg. And if you already know where it is, you can just pick it up, right? But other times your goal is just map an entire area and you just want to map everything. But then you sort of have the things in the middle where you need to be able to explore in order to be able to exploit it well. So for example, with the propeller example that Katie gave at the beginning, you need to sort of explore the area around and have a good idea of what's happening in order to then exploit and take the best pictures of the propeller. So the question there is then, how do we quantify the trade-off? And that's the question I'm going to ask you. So if you have a way that you know to assign your word for exploiting things, you have a way to assign your word for exploring things, how do you quantify something that's doing both? So you guys think about that.
So maybe you could have some sort of hyperparameter that quantifies, and like you use like expressions of, not loss functions, but like, so if you're trying to minimize the mean for one and you're trying to minimize the variance for the other, then maybe you could have a way to sum and then try to minimize all of that.
Yeah, exactly. That's exactly what we're going to do. We're going to basically just sum up the reward. So we have the reward we're getting for the exploiting term, which you said was often like the mean, and we have the reward for the exploration, which is often the variance, and we'll maybe just multiply one of them by a constant so that we can tweak our constant depending on how exploited versus exploited it we want to be. And this is exactly what we see done in the literature. So for example, the upper confidence bound rule does basically exactly that. You're taking your mean plus your variance, and you have this coefficient beta in front of it. The exact formulation of beta is, you know, in the paper, it's designed to have all sorts of properties, but this is really the big idea. So for example, over here you can see that we have a graph of the mean, right? And then we have the variance also in this blue region. And so if we wanted to be explorative and exploitative, so purely exploitative, we would definitely go for this point here. Purely explorative, we'd always sort of go for these regions where we don't really know what's happening. But if we wanted to do both, we would say, okay, well, you know, we know we can go here and have a pretty good reward. we think it's maybe not that likely that we could go here and get a good reward, but there is some chance, right? Like, the variance is sort of wide enough that maybe this is worth checking out, right? And so then if you go over here, you can check it, you can see, oh, you know, that's not what we expected, and then the next time you go through, maybe like the peak of this is a little bit lower than that, so now we can just start exploiting. And so we can get the behavior where we are both exploring and exploiting, but we're doing it sort of smartly, right? We're looking at the, like, we're only exploring the places that we think have a reasonably high potential of being worth exploring. Another way that this is done, so this one uses mutual information. I'm not going to go too in-depth with this, I just want to point out that it's, again, basically the same idea where we have the mean plus the variance. Here the variance is also a function of the mutual information, and it has this coefficient of helpless. And then the last thing I want to talk about is how do you stop your adaptive sampling? So now that we talked about the different actions you might take for assigning a reward and for how you want to represent your actions, how do you stop your adaptive sampling? And the way this is usually done is just with a budget. So eventually you're going to run out of resources, and adaptive sampling will maybe keep track of those resources and say, okay, our next action is actually, let's go home. So the budgets that are often used are just, you know, how far did you travel, how many samples do you take, how much time do you use, or the total energy expended. You might think of that maybe there's better stopping criteria, and we're actually going to talk about that in a little bit, but these are really the ones that you see in literature. So once you have your algorithm that you build together with all of the different choices you make, so just talk about some choices, I talked about some choices, how do you evaluate your algorithm? The way that's usually used in the literature is regret. I don't think regret is necessarily a particularly great metric, but it's certainly an easy-to-measure metric, so I guess that's what people have decided on. And all regret is the expected sort of loss of reward for all of the choices you made. So instantaneous regret is basically saying that each time step you did a thing, the perfect version of the algorithm, the oracle, would have done something else. What's the difference between? And then accumulative regret is the sum of all of it. You can see, you know, if you were doing everything perfectly, you would hopefully have no regret. If you, you know, often aren't, then depending on how much you deviate from the perfect thing, you would have some amount of regret. I'll note here that, so we talked about comparing your planner to an oracle. I think you usually don't have an oracle. So an oracle is like the perfect knowledge. You usually don't have that. So often what you'll use instead is the knowledge you had by the end. So if you have your world model and you're basing everything on your world model as you go, you might want to just use the world model that you had at the very end and say, okay, so imagine we had that all of the time along the way. What would we have done differently? And this is useful for testing how your algorithm does and like comparing different algorithms in a similar environment. With that, we're going to start talking about some applications.
Hi folks, I'm Victoria. Not to put a too fine a point on it, but we just talked to you for a long time about lots of different things, right? So you're probably getting a sense that adaptive sampling is something that as a human you need to adapt for your purposes or design for your purposes. And there's several things worth designing for. There's how you choose your world model, like out of your process, is it a base net, is it an occupancy grid? You want to have a sense of the different options you have in that space. So where can I go to sample? What instruments do I have to deploy? Things like that. So we need to be able to simulate doing something useful in that world. And once we can simulate doing something useful, we need a way to evaluate its usefulness. And that's this reward idea. This is like a decision rule that we might use. We pick the best one. We send that to a controller. It closes a loop. Samples, we update our world, so on and so forth, and eventually we run out of time or battery or, I don't know, interest, and we stop doing our adaptive sampling thing. Right now, what we want to do is try to give some intuition about how this is applied in the literature in like real, actual case studies. These might be a little dense, so if at any point you have a question, please feel free to ask. And I also want to preface this section by saying that everything we present here will be in the context of performing some sort of science objective with an adaptive sampler. And perhaps the most canonical example of doing this is the sensor selection problem. The literature is really theoretical, so we're going to ground this in a pretty easy to understand example in a marine space. So I'm working with a group of scientists right now at PUI, and they're actually very interested in modeling methane in the Wareham River, which is a little bit south of here, because there's a big wastewater treatment plant that pumps into this estuary. They happen to use methane as part of their treatment process, and it has some interesting ramifications about the environment, and it's all really cool science that's above my head as a roboticist, but I'm trying to help them out. In a future project, maybe far down the line, they're interested in perhaps deploying this sensor network of smart buoys. And the utility of doing this is that when they go out to collect their physical water samples, they want to know where to sample for two reasons. One, they want to get representative samples of the river, and two, they want to sample places that might actually contain high methane. So when we think about formulating this as an adaptive sampling problem, for example, if I'm out on the Wareham River, I want to characterize the river quickly, so I have a limited time to query all these buoys, I can't query them all at once, we might call this a sequential selection problem. So in what order can I optimize selecting, querying these buoys in order to characterize what the scientists want? In terms of what we've been talking about in the adaptive sampler design, we can choose a belief model. We're going to use a GP in this. It's perhaps not the best for a river, and we'll talk about reasons why it's perhaps not best for a river. But in the literature, this is what's chosen. We're going to choose a reward function. Because the scientists want to both get a good idea of what's going on in the river and choose high places to sample methane, we're going to use the UCB rule, which we know is an explore exploit thing. We have a limited number of queries we can make for the network, and we're going to do this in a myopic, greedy way, which is to say, because we're not restricted about, you know, from this buoy to this buoy, I have to query them in that order. I can query this one and then query this one. It's fine to do a one-step look ahead. If we remember that algorithm from before, we know that given our set of options to query and given some model, we just use our UCB rule to make a decision about which one to query at that time. And we know that, as Lotta explained, this UCB rule is trying to balance choosing uncertain points and certain points, the explore-exploit thing. Not to put a too fine point on it, but that means everything that we do for adaptive sampling basically comes down to what this reward function is in the sensor selection problem. That's a lot of responsibility. What if the scientist doesn't trust that the UCB rule is doing what we say it's doing? How do we convince them that indeed you can trust us to query this network and tell you where to go? And this is a very, very cool set of mathematical proofs. I'm not going to go in detail, you're welcome, but I'm going to try to give you some intuition about, particularly focusing on this formulation of beta, this choice of this beta parameter. If we choose beta correctly, the result is that we can have a no-regret property, which means as we query the network, eventually we're going to converge with the optimal planner. Now, of course, at infinitum, that makes a lot of sense. If I query every node that's possible, then I better have a pretty good model at the end. What if I can only query a selection of them, a sample of them? How can I make some guarantee about my performance? And this is where beta comes in. Let's imagine that f of x is this summed term here. And so our mean function looks something like this, and we have a uniform prior, and that's scaled by our beta term, gets our reward, everything clear and kosher, right? We're going to take the maximum of f of x, so that's this point here, fine, and we're going to sample at that point. We're going to query that buoy. So we expect that we're going to update these points. So our mean might shift around a little, and our uncertainty should drop, right, because now we've actually sampled that point in real space. This is going to have an impact on the next thing that we're trying to optimize for, right? So if this moves around and this drops to zero, this point in the graph, we would think would kind of flatten out, right? We get less reward from resampling the same place. Makes a lot of sense. I wouldn't want to just sit on the same buoy over and over again. So let's make our update. Awesome. It did all the things we said it would. It's almost like I planned these slides. And we're going to do this again. So So we're going to choose the next best point to sample, our maxima. We're going to update these things again. Excellent. We're going to see all these things change. Great. Now, you might notice that our new maxima, if we assume beta is constant, is kind of in the same place that we sampled before. And this kind of brings up an interesting question. What if we didn't make beta big enough to value uncertainty? What if this mean value that we believe is true and the uncertainty, like these things added together, will never be as good as just the pure mean of these two points? That doesn't seem like a great strategy if we're trying to convince someone that we can know for sure, or know probabilistically or most likely that we've seen everything there is to see. What if indeed there's a high point here and our model is wrong? Well, I propose, what if beta is an increasing function in time? So as time goes on, this is valued more and more. So this point becomes more and more attractive until it's a place to sample. And we actually go and do that thing. In literature, this is exactly what they do. They have some sort of fancy term for beta. It's an increasing function. It makes a lot of sense. The intuition here is, if there are places we haven't looked, then there is something to regret. So if we have a finite number of places that we have to sample, we can say that our performance is bounded by how much we explore. And what's particularly interesting is that beta can be a function of things that we know already about our model. In particular, our set of V, this is our set of buoys, the number of places we can possibly sample from, and some term that we can define as scientists. The intuition here is that V is a direct function of beta, or they're directly related. So as the number of places to sample increases, our relative value of beta also increases. If there's more to sample from, then there's more reward to possibly incur. Alternatively, if there's more places to look, there's more regret for not looking. It's kind of the intuition there. And depending on your particular application, again, of course, there's something that you have to tune as the roboticist, you can kind of temper this effect of the number of sampling places with delta. It's an indirect function in this formulation, but you can kind of choose it. The important thing is, if beta takes this form, you can tell the scientist for sure, I will see things and be able to tell you pretty well what to do. Now, this is great for biopic planning, and sensor networks are in this beautifully idealized situation, right? So I don't have to travel anywhere. I can sit at my computer next to the river, and the scientists can do all the sampling. But I think we're taking a cognitive robotics course, so why don't we talk about this in terms of a robotics problem? In a pretty recent paper, this is a pretty active field right now, the team of scientists under Aurora have looked at this problem from a planetary sense. So you have a terrestrial robot, you send it to Mars, as you do, I guess, with terrestrial robots, and it's equipped with several sensors. It has a camera that it can always use to look around, and it has two or three instruments it can use to actually perform geological measurements of the rocks. And it has to choose where to go and which instrument to deploy and all of this really interesting stuff. The goal, to study Martian rocks and navigate around and do this as best as possible to convince the scientists that they can make some interesting claims about the science of Martian rocks. Sure. The limitation here is that every instrument you deploy incurs a cost, and the length of time you can explore every day is limited, perhaps in the solar day based on the battery or the power cycle of the robot. And the robot itself is in a pretty extreme environment, so we know that one day the robot will not be able to do any more studying of rocks. And when that day comes, we want to make sure that we have gained as much information as possible, as optimally, from our unknown environment. Let's look at how we would do this as an adaptive sampling problem. We're going to choose a belief model. Now, in Aurora's paper, they choose to use a Bayes net, not a GP. And the reason is they're studying this idea of a scientist in the loop. If the robot has a camera that's basically free and it sees a red rock, then it can kind of query the network and say, oh, if I see a red rock, I know these things about it, and I'm going to choose to use this sensor to validate my model. Or if I see a green rock, then I'm going to validate it by looking at this sensor and things like that. This isn't well encoded by a GP, so a BayesNet captures all those relationships. Because we also care about exploring and exploiting, which is kind of a theme in science robotics, we're also going to use the UCB rule, which we just described in detail, and I'm going to save you another description of that. We have a cost, so we have a budget that I'm looking for. And instead of looking myopically, let's actually plan ahead. Because paths sort of cascade into each other, you know, going here now isn't great, but getting there later is really important, so I'm willing to take the cost, is an important consideration for a robot to make. When we actually put this on a robot, as Lada described earlier, the fundamental algorithm is pretty much the same. We make sure we're within our budget, we choose an action to take, we sample, we update our belief, we rinse and repeat until the end of time, or until we stop. The key difference here is instead of choosing a single action, we're actually choosing a sequence of actions, which can be modeled or abstracted through a Monte Carlo tree search or other types of searches. What's really critical about the results of this paper is that they proved empirically that they can make some generalizations that a non-myopic planner for robotic systems might actually be better than a myopic one. Let's build some intuition about that. Assume that we have a totally random algorithm. We choose to go here and deploy this instrument, it's totally unprincipled. But we'll gain a small amount of information about the world. We imagine that this is our baseline that we want to improve. Let's say we do the next naive game. We choose a fixed algorithm. So if I see a red rock, I always deploy this sensor, a green one, it's always this one, and I always go left. We might perform a little better than randomly, but perhaps not that well. Let's now think about our myopic planner. We know for sensor networks it works pretty well. And we see that for a robotics problem it also works pretty well. If I do a one-step look ahead, I'm always going to choose the locally optimal thing to do, which hopefully is always better than the random robotics thing to do, and that accumulates in time. But if I can look really far ahead in this particular problem, I can actually make some pretty significant gains if my sensing budget is large enough. So if the amount of the solar day is long enough, or my expected lifetime of the robot is long enough, I can actually make some interesting empirical claims about how globally optimal, or as Marsily, planetarily optimal, I can make my planner. This is a really recent paper. The using of BayesNets is actually crazy. Like, it hasn't really been done before in this context, in the informative path planning context. And it brings to mind the fact that there's a ton of open area in this research field. In fact, the number of communities, research communities, who use adaptive sampling techniques is great, like large. There's Bayesian optimization, there's active learning, machine learning, deep learning, that's a buzzword, right? And all of these other fields. And it's important to note that some of the key open areas for science contexts are in this modeling space. So I told you I'd get back to this river. This is an actual plot of methane on a single day in the Wareham River. You can see that it actually changes a lot. Using a typical GP model to model, to like capture this idea, might not actually be a great idea. No one's doing work right now to actually think about the spatio-temporal phenomenon of most things in science. Now, the rock situation is a little different. Hopefully there aren't rocks crawling all over the surface of Mars and they can use a GP model or a BayesNet pretty well. But in the marine environment, we don't have those luxuries. Tides, currents, they all make a big difference, and modeling those well is a nice idea. In a similar way, if we don't have a good model, then how do we actually know that we don't have a good model? Well, regret is a really convenient metric for talking about the algorithm itself. How do we know if the science we're doing is good? So our information gain is interesting. Talking about number of bits I've learned is interesting, but what does that mean for a scientist? And finally, as a practical consideration, you might have a situation where you might want to stop before the end of your battery life. You imagine a ship deployment, it costs $50,000 a day, you probably have several missions you want to run, and you want to run those missions efficiently. If you were to tell the robot for every mission, run until the end of your battery, you might actually be missing out on information you can gain in other places. Hear me out. Your You're on a pond, you're looking at plankton. We already talked about this. But imagine that the plankton is uniformly distributed in this pond. It's like the least interesting plankton field you can imagine. The robot probably doesn't need 8 hours to figure that out. What if it could tell you in 2 hours, and you could save 6 hours, go to a new pond, and deploy there? It's a huge consideration to make. In more complicated environments, there's other considerations. If I were to stop here versus here, what do I lose out on? Maybe it's only this little hotspot here. Now, this is totally fake graphic, so don't read into it too much. But there's some interesting work to be done there as well. So hopefully this builds a little intuition for you. You can connect with us later if you're interested in reading any of these papers. Or perhaps you use adaptive sampling in your own research, and these are things that can help you. Fingers crossed. So Katie is going to actually give us some final thoughts about the whole adaptive sampling thing.
Yeah, so I'm going to wrap up and like summarize some of like, the key points of the lecture. This is sort of like some of the TLDR. If you know, you were paying attention in the beginning when there were Easter eggs, but then you were like, oh, there's like a bunch of math, it's scary. Like, you back in and like get some of like the big picture stuff. Yeah, so as I mentioned before, adaptive sampling like fits into the pipeline and like everything else that like people have been talking about. In terms of you have an environment you're looking at, you sense that environment, you make a world model that might be like something like a slam map or like a GP belief, you can have like lots of options. And then within that model of the world, you plan out different types of things you can do and then pick the best action, like the best decision to do, pass it into like a path planner, and then actually like, you know, take that. That's like where adaptive sampling fits in this whole process. And adaptive sampling itself is, again, taking the world model and then within that world model, you simulate different possible actions you can take and assign reward to them. And then you want to after like simulating different possible things, pick the action with the best reward. And then after some amount of time, you stop. So here's like a nice like grid with like all of the big things we talked about. Adaptive sampling is in many respects just about like making a lot of like choices for how you're representing them differently. Like less about the algorithm itself, and more about like which options do you like pick. It's sort of like a mix and match type thing. So for world model, some of our model options are a Bayesian. That was like the thing with the nodes and the arrows between the nodes. And it's really useful when you have like sequences of steps. Like, you know, if I see X, then I will do Y. An optimum grid is like for robots, they're sort of like modeling. Like, where is their stuff? Is this like space occupied or is it like empty? Gaussian processes were like the sort of like red green shading we saw at the beginning, if you remember that. That's sort of representing like how likely is a thing to be at this place, like a Gaussian distribution. The reward is like what we're looking for, what we're looking to gain. And the big trade off in reward is explore versus exploit. If you recall, exploring is finding out information about the world, like minimizing variance and entropy and like trying to like learn stuff. And exploit is going with like a particular goal and like just you want something, you go for it, you don't really care about like learning more stuff. So going back to the initial Easter egg hunt analogy and like the various locations you could go, the exploit is like, okay, you know that there are like other people hunting for eggs there, you know that there are definitely eggs there, like you have like, you like expect that you'll like definitely get some eggs, and that's like what you go for. But if you're exploring, you might want to go to like the bushes and all grass, because you're not quite sure if there's eggs, but since there's like high variance, and if there are eggs there, you're probably going to be able to find a lot more since no one else has been. And then what we're doing is we're trying to sort of like model the trade-off between explore and exploit. And then we model this trade-off using the UCB rule and mean mutual information rule, which are basically taking, you know, how much are we weighting exploring versus how much are we weighting exploiting. The action representation, several components. There's how you sample. We talked about, are you sampling at like, you know, different discrete waypoints, or are you continuously sampling? The entire time as you go along. And discrete like waypoint sampling is like a lot more realistic, but you might need to miss key features. And so that's something to consider. There's also how you like look ahead when you're deciding on your actions to plan off it. It's sort of the short sighted, it's like one step ahead. Just like sort of like the community approach there. And non-myopic is like looking at many steps into the future, sort of a far-sighted approach. And you might use something like the Monte Carlo search tree, like Lotta showed, to sample like out of a space of like lots of like possible like steps and actions, and get a representative sample of what sorts of actions you can gain. And finally, there's a stop criterion. And stop criterion is typically after you consume a certain number of resources, like given a certain amount of time, or you've run out of battery life, or it's after you've gotten a certain amount of information that you want, like you know, maybe you can only take so many samples. And then, as Victoria mentioned, there's also sort of like a frontier of like how can we like do better, make better choices. Like can we find some sort of work model that incorporates how things change with like respective time. Or can we stop the hearing that actually like responds to what we've seen? We're not learning very much, and we can do better elsewhere. Can we just like decide to stop early because what we're looking at isn't very useful? Yeah. So this is basically big ideas and like all of the different definitions of things we're talking about. And just the bottom line on like what adaptive sampling is. Closing the loop on classic surveying techniques instead of doing like mowing the lawn paths. We're looking at what we know and we're trying to do better autonomously. Any questions?
Can you say a little bit more about the trade-off between using mutual information and using versus proximity as your exploration?
Got it. You want to? There's like a lot of slides. Yeah, going back to certain slides.
Okay. I mean, I think it's once again just the context of what you're modeling, right? So you probably are going to be using mutual information when you think there's mutual information between a million things, right? So I think, I don't remember the exact example of the papers, but you know, if you're building a flood map and consecutive places have mutual information, then you probably want to incorporate mutual information in your final cost function. And over here, there's not really, like this is, I think, basically the Gaussian process, so you're not, like any mutual information is sort of already taken into account by like the variance. I guess, so like the variance being wide, or being narrow here means it's also narrower close by. So it doesn't directly make that. I don't know if that answers your question, or if you have more.
I guess, to be very clear, I'm very, very familiar with the UCB rule, but less familiar with the mutual information rule, but one way that I'm intuitively considering it like, right now, so I'm sorry if this is wrong, is that perhaps we could formulate this problem in terms of multiple variables of interest or perhaps observations that correlate with a scientific goal, but something that is not directly observable. So for example, for methane, there aren't that many in-situ methane sensors, so when we're querying that sample buoy network or whatever it is, perhaps we're only looking at other readings like dissolved oxygen or carbon dioxide, and those could indicate to us, those could provide some mutual information about what we could expect from methane, right? So that would be our H of X given Y term,
yeah.
Something like that. Perhaps that's interesting. So it could encode a sense of some relationships in the world.
I think mutual information in general is when you have less, I guess, direct information, you want to take more into account the indirect information of other variables.
This seems to be at one level that UCB versus entropy of mutual information are trying to achieve two different objectives, right? So normally I think of UCB is used as I'm trying to find the best thing to do, right? And what it's trying to do is to say, is it a bird hand versus two in the bush? Do I know what the best one is now versus I could do a bit better by exploring, right? And UCB is trying to capture kind of the probability that there's something out better than the bird in hand, right? So in those cases, if I want the best solution, right, or if I want the best answer, which is the best place to go, then I would use UCB, right? If I'm using entropy, for example, then that's generally trying to say I'm trying to get as accurate of a model across the board, and so I want to reduce as much confusion,
right?
And that seems like mutual information is kind of a variant from entropy, but in both cases, it's still an overall uncertainty reduction. Is that right?
Yeah. So I think, maybe something that's a little bit confusing here is that we talk about mutual information as a like exploration, as an exploration property, because it is really talking about it's another way to measure the amount of like uncertainty. But here, this is just another example of an explore and exploit trade-off that just happens to use mutual information. So like, the rule is mean and mutual information rule that has mutual information in the name. But this is an explore-exploit strategy, whereas I guess by itself, just using mutual information is the exploration part.
Okay. On the last slide, you had sort of all the options we had for each step of the adaptive sampling. But I think the stop criteria, I think they were all budget based. With like a global entropy be like a newer stop criteria as a mini storm.
Yes.
But,
in the literature, basically, people just use budgets. And I think what we were saying that one open area is using something other than a budget.
Right. So I think So this happens to be my research, to be totally transparent, or related to it. What's interesting is that a budget is set because it's really convenient, right? Like, we know exactly how long a robot's going to last in the field. What is perhaps more difficult to formulate is, when is it good enough to stop? So global entropy reduction, sure. So we can assume that it's going to be asymptotic, and at some point in the curve, it's probably pretty reasonable to say, yeah, we're good. But when in that curve is it fine? Like, we kind of have to have a pretty good sense of our context in order to say when it's okay.